You're listening to the B&H Photography Podcast. For over 40 years, B&H has been the professional source for photography, video, audio, and more. For your favorite gear, news, and reviews, visit us at bnh.com or download the B&H app to your iPhone or Android device. Now here's your host, Alan Weitz.
Greetings and welcome to the B&H Photography Podcast. Today's topic, lens adapters. Though they've been available from companies like Novaflex for the longest time, most shooters didn't bother with them or even care that they existed until mirrorless cameras started coming to market about 8 years ago. I currently shoot with a Sony A7 series camera using lenses from four different manufacturers. I also own a set of adapters that allow me to use these very same lenses on Micro Four Thirds cameras with equal ease. Some of my lenses I purchased new, while others are older lenses that I previously would never have even considered using. In my book, this is a big deal, and the creative qualities of my photographs reflect that claim. Today, John and I will be chatting with Victor Samoilovich and Johnny Tsang. Aside from being avid users of lens adapters, both Victor and Johnny have a wealth of experience helping customers in our Manhattan superstore find the right lens and adapter combination for their particular needs. Before we begin, let me remind you, your thoughts and opinions are very important to us. So take a few moments if you have a chance and tweet us at BH Photo Video with hashtag BH Photo Podcast and rate us on iTunes. That said, gentlemen, let's start talking about lens adapters. Johnny, could you tell us what a lens adapter is for those of you who out there who never had a chance to use it, and what do you use it for? What's the deal with them?
Sure, not a problem. Lens adapters is actually a device that allows you to use one lens from one manufacturer to a different manufacturer in which it was not designed for. A basic example is such as using, you know, a Nikon lens on a Canon camera or a Nikon or a Canon lens on a Sony camera. Basically, it allows you to expand your horizon of lens choices. Instead of being stuck to the original equipment manufacturer type lenses, you can actually branch out to using any manufacturer.
Why were we stuck before, though?
Most of the people would generally adapt their lenses for cinema use more so than for photography, as the current lenses that we have now for most of these full-frame cameras can actually still transition over to mirrorless cameras that are full-frame and still get the same coverage.
And that's due to flange mount.
That's correct.
Flange, okay.
Can you explain flange mount a little bit? The flange distance?
Flange distance, yes, I stand corrected.
Flange distance is basically the rear of the lens in which it comes into contact with the body mount and the distance from where the film plane would actually be. So therefore, you know, depending on that distance, you may or may not be able to actually achieve focus.
And with mirrorless cameras, the flange distance is smaller, and most DSLRs...
Given the fact that there isn't a mirror box, yes.
Yeah, so all of these older lenses, they have larger flange mounts because they mostly used for DSLRs, and now with mirrorless cameras, it's
due to
a
lack of mirror box, yeah. So yeah, you can actually, you know, make an adapter a lot easier than actually having to work with the mirror box.
What kind of adapters are available? I know it's not just a metal ring that goes between part
A
and
part B. Well,
there
are many types. The most common ones are the ones that you just mentioned, the basic metal rings that adapt one lens manufacturer to another camera body manufacturer. Mm-hmm. You also have more specialty adapters, such as ones that retain autofocus, be it from the OEM manufacturer or perhaps even third-party manufacturers, such as Metabones. Metabones has one for the Canon EOS mount to use on the Sony NEX that still retains aperture control and autofocus for certain Sony bodies. So that's another specialty one that allows for autofocus. And another one is what they call speed boosters for your smaller formats such as Micro Four Third or APS-C. What that does is it actually allows you to use full-frame lenses. And as you know, using full-frame lens on a crop sensor, you actually lose the true focal length of that lens. So with this, it actually allows you to shoot slightly wider and also give you one full stop as far as your aperture is concerned. So you actually get a faster lens and one that's closer to what the lens is actually designed for that focal distance.
Can you give us an idea of some of the manufacturers that are out there making adapters?
All right. Well, I mean, there are a lot of basic ones that we carry at B&H. Velo is a very popular option because it's fairly inexpensive and it'll do the job. Step up from there, for autofocus mounts, you have Metabones, which is the most popular one right now. For Canon to Sony, though, they're not exactly the cheapest thing on the market. They're about $400, if I'm not mistaken. Photo Deox is another great one. Sony actually tested the Photo Deox EOS to NEX adapter, and they actually claim that that works every bit just as well as the Metabones. And that's at a fraction of the cost. I think it's about $100 or $120 at the most. Yeah, that's a great option. And then, of course, the cream of the crop, though you don't actually have autofocus, is going to be Novaflex. They're German made. They're very, very high end. But again, you know, it's very expensive too. So.
And they're the cream of the crop because they're just so well made.
The way that they're machined and the way that they're engineered, it's almost flawless. It, mm-hmm. You know, after putting the adapter on, it's almost like, you know, an OEM lens where, you know, there are no faults, there are no, you know, creaks or anything like that. I mean, it's just mechanical perfection almost.
But I think one of the big criteria for adapters, anybody who's used them, is that it has to do with precision of machining. Because again, if you have a camera and you have a lens from the same manufacturer, when you mount it to the camera, it's a nice solid fit. Now we're introducing little pieces between all that. So if the machining isn't dead on, it doesn't feel tight on the camera. There's a little bit of rattle and stuff, and that could affect your focus and other aspects.
Absolutely,
of it.
Yeah. So, I mean, you know, reason why Novaflex is so expensive because of, you know, the precision in their engineering. It, like I said, it feels like it's OEM. So,
being so expensive, they're also manual. They're not. They don't provide automatic.
Yes,
or
they
any
are.
Communication
they haven't actually
lens
had.
And camera, right?
Yeah, they don't have that technology in their adapters. Most of the people who buy their adapters are generally the guys who are doing cinema, in which case autofocus is not necessary.
Right.
So as far as I know, I mean, most of the guys who buy, you know, like PL mount adapters and, you know, stuff like that, they generally buy Novaflex.
Yeah, Novaflex has also been around forever. They were making adapters before I even knew why I would want to have an adapter. So they've got a good leg on things.
And in the store, you guys are seeing the effects of mirrorless cameras. You're seeing an increased
interest in adapters. With adapters, I mean, you know, it allows you to have an inexpensive method of getting lenses that you could never get previously. For example, a Canon 50 1.2L right now averages, I think the retail price is around $1,400. Mm-hmm. You can get the old FD mount for about, I mean, $700-$800. So you're still getting the Canon L quality, but then, you know, all you don't have is autofocus and the latest coatings. And with that, you just buy an adapter and you slap it onto any camera. Now you have Canon L quality at, you know, a fraction of the cost of what it would cost to buy a brand new one. So.
Right. Not to mention, Victor, you can talk a lot about this, about the use of older lenses, rangefinder lenses, and, of course, you know, quality glass from Leica, Zeiss.
Absolutely.
I think, Victor, you might be the only person here who actually haunts the used department more than I do.
Well, so. I beg to differ. I'm always there, too. Yeah, they're actually trying to ban me from the used department, so, you know, they can help me save some money. So
I think Johnny has his share of time there.
So what do you use, Victor?
I use Fuji XE2 camera and quite a few different old lenses simply because I prefer the character of those lenses over modern counterparts. Some of the lenses made in the 70s, as an example, very common, one of a Leica Summicron, whether it's an R mount or M mount, I find still superior to a modern lenses that are made by a manufacturer. Many of our customers a lot of people from younger generation seem to flock to Leica cameras without being able to afford them. Mm-hmm. One of the things they like, of course, in Leica is a rangefinder system, but also a manual focus, the feel of manual focus. Mm-hmm. It's an entirely different experience. And once you use this type of equipment, it's very difficult to switch to autofocus. Autofocus is convenient, but it's not so intuitive to me. There are quite a few lenses you see on the market that went up in value, and I think it's due to mirrorless cameras.
No, that's why I hate the mirrorless market right now, because everything I want is going up in price.
I started using adapters many years ago. When I saw a first mirrorless camera, at that time I recall it was one of the first Olympus digital cameras. I purchased it immediately. With the thought of using my exotic lenses on the digital camera. And that's how it started.
And what adapter did you buy at that time?
Actually, the very original adapter I bought was a Novaflex. Mm-hmm. At that time, it was around $200 that I've used my Leica R lens with a Canon EOS, which, you know, this adapter is still available, and I see it on the floor quite often with the customers that carry large Canon EOS. It was one of the small Summicron Rs made in the 60s. The lens is beautifully machined, and it also has a very different footprint and just the feeling about the picture is completely different than with the modern lenses.
Yeah, because that's the thing. I mean, due to, you know, modern day of digital technology, all these so-called pixel peepers, you know, they just want to see, you know, critical sharpness and all that. But they start losing, you know, the beauty of, you know, the character of each lens. That's why a lot of people are flocking towards that again. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, Zeiss Otis, you know, you're talking like, what, $3,000-$4,000 for 50 mil. Yeah, you know, that's the highest resolving lens on the market, one of the highest. It's, you know, a beautiful, beautiful lens. But, I mean, it's, you know, some people say it's kind of cold. It lacks character. I mean, compared to, you know, like a classic, you know, 50 Kron or something like that. You know, I mean, they're both, you know, great lenses, but, you know, there's difference to it, you know. Mm-hmm.
Sometimes the deficiencies of a lens are what make it especially appealing.
Absolutely.
I have some lenses that they have what would be called optical flaws, but used in the right way, it actually really further interprets the photograph and just adds so much to
it. If you look at the cinema industry today, actually B&H, you know, they don't stock these lenses because they're very expensive. One of the most famous optical manufacturers is Cook from England.
Yeah.
If you notice, we also have in our database uncoated elements that can be replaced because people want that particular look. It is more organic look than, you know, the typical harsh, sharp, colorful, modern digital look.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, I lenses to me are a lot like brushes to a painter, and every brush has a certain kind of a mark and texture to it. And you can't use, you know, the brush that you use to paint a sky, you're not going to use for small details. The same thing for lenses. They each have their personalities, and some lenses lend themselves to certain types of photographs. And I think that's one of the beauties of adapters is that you can now orchestrate a lens set for different kind of purposes.
You can also get a very different look. You mentioned the Micro Four Thirds cameras.
Yeah.
And if you look at that format, it's actually the same thing as an old 35-millimeter movie film.
Mm-hmm.
Because the 35 frame is not 24 by 36 millimeter. It's half of that.
Yeah.
And it with an appearance of this camera, it became quite popular to use old bollocks lenses or old, you know, C-mount style lenses, which actually don't even cover Micro Four Thirds, but they give a certain character, which is unlike Holga look.
Yes.
It vignettes a little bit in the corners, but the lenses are still of supreme quality, and a lot of people use it as, you know, for special effects or just, again, different feel of a picture.
Now, that being said, I mean, the craziest thing I've done is use a Pentax 110, you know, lens on my Sony full frame. So
you had mentioned it. Does it vignettes, doesn't it?
Absolutely. I shoot in APS-C, you know, mode, so it doesn't vignette as much.
Ah,
and it
okay.
actually seemed to cover, you know, most, you know, APS-C frames, surprisingly, even though, you know, 110 film is pretty small, but...
Let me ask. We're kind of geeking out here, which is great. This is what we want to do. But for your average everyday shooter, and even to some degree for, let's say, your pro who wants things to be as efficient as possible and is most likely going to be using autofocus, I mean, does this conversation apply? I mean, how can adapters help your regular photographer? Other than, of course, what you're mentioning about if they have a mirrorless system and they want to try old lenses, but...
It's funny you mention that because my cousin and I, my cousin was the one who got me into photography back when I was 12, and, you know, he and I, we'd always go back and forth with these discussions, and I used to be heavy into the Canon system, and then I started branching out into this whole mirrorless thing. So we would frequently have these conversations about, you know, adapters. But his argument is that, you know, it doesn't really help the pro because, you know, you're adding one more medium that can go wrong. And, you know, when fumbling in the field, you know, it's kind of counterintuitive to actually have to work with, you know, multiple manufacturers, which I do agree with him. But then at the same time, he's talking strictly from a working photographer standpoint, but not so much a cinematographer standpoint.
Right.
So I see with adapters, I think it's more relevant for cinematographers more so than photographers. If you're shooting probably, you know, like studio work or, you know, just a light portrait session where movement and, you know, tracking things aren't as essential, then I can see adapters, you know, playing a role because you can get unique looks from certain lenses like we've mentioned before. But if you're actually working in the field such as weddings and stuff like that, I don't really see, you know, this being an effective method unless you're shooting strictly like zone focus or something where you're shooting with ultra wide and everything is in focus at f11 or something. So,
and when kind of going from there, can you speak a bit about automatic adapters and how they are working, how they're kind of communicating autofocus, and are they effective?
Yes and no. It all depends on the camera. I mean, because Sony, they have their OEM adapters that allow them to use Sony alpha mount lenses, which from my experience, I've played with it. I think the the 4, which has the mirror in it, mm-hmm. works fairly well. But then I was told the one without the mirror should work fairly well with the A7 R2 and the current A6300 because of its ridiculously fast autofocus system. Mm-hmm. So I can see that working, but then it defeats the purpose of mirrorless because the whole reason for getting a mirrorless camera is to get a compact setup.
Right.
Now you're using larger lenses on it, in which case you're better off just using a traditional, you know, I guess SLR, SLT, or whatever it is that you're using. Mm-hmm. And then when it comes to metabones, yes and no, or metabones and photodiox and the like, because since they're not truly designed from the same manufacturer, there's always that potential issue in which it can go wrong because Canons were never designed to be used on mirrorless cameras. It was designed to use for mainly their system. I mean, Canon themselves had an adapter also from the Canon EOS to the Canon mirrorless or the Canon EOS M, which I actually have owned the first generation. It worked fairly well, but I mean, the battery just tend to drain quite a bit too because certain lenses have image stabilization, and when that's activated on your mirrorless camera, you're actually draining the battery in your mirrorless camera. So mm-hmm. that's one of the major downfalls, that, you know, because of the adapter, you lose the efficiency because, you know, there's one item in between your camera and your lens. And also, mirrorless cameras aren't known to have long battery life anyways. Now right. with the introduction of image stabilization from the lens, you know, being using your camera body as a source, that's draining the power even more so. So that's some of the common issues that, you know, you'd have to think about before actually, you know, going through the adapter
right.
route.
Yeah,
so
that's a good point. Good point. Yeah. You had talked about the shoot without lens mode, and which is something that you need to know about if you're going to be using
yes,
an adapter.
Yeah,
on
you definitely want to make sure that your camera is actually capable of shooting without a lens. The camera system gives us the most issue I've seen so far is Samsung. Mm-hmm. For some reason, I mean, the idea for Samsung cameras is great. I mean, you know, their NX1 is amazing, 28 megs, you know, APS-C, blazing fast frame rate. But I mean, you know, the whole beauty of mirrorless system is to be able to adapt lenses. And from what I've noticed, they don't have a shoot without lens. Therefore, that kind of shot themselves in the foot. I mean, because let's be honest, if you're buying a mirrorless system, most mirrorless manufacturers don't actually have a full system, you know, of lenses. So you're going to want to start, you know, venturing into, you know, third-party lenses to start playing with. That being said, there aren't any third-party options that have autofocus or much of it. So that's why you'd resort to your older, you know, lenses that we've been discussing. Mm-hmm. And because you can't shoot without lens, that's kind of meaningless.
Can you explain that a bit, or either of you, a bit, the shoot without lens mode? Because
basically, it enables you to take a lens off and still fire the shutter. A lot of cameras are designed in a way that if everything is not perfectly in place, the camera doesn't work, which is actually a good safety.
Yeah, if there isn't any communication between the lens, you know, because lenses have electronic contacts for autofocus and aperture control, but, you know, since there's no contact or no communication, technically there's no lens on it. Even though, you know, we have a manual lens projecting the image onto the sensor. So that's one issue that, you know, because it doesn't allow you to just snap a blank shot, in theory, you can't actually use it with a manual lens.
And are most manufacturers, other than Samsung, they're including this in their cameras, right?
Most of them I know, yeah, all of them, you know, tend to have a shoot without lens. Just Samsung's the only one that gave us issues.
Mm-hmm. Okay, we're going to take a short break, and we come back, we're going to talk about the advantages and disadvantages of lens adapters.
There's plenty of that.
We hope you're enjoying this edition of the B&H Photography Podcast. Send us a tweet at BH Photo Video, hashtag BH Photo Podcast.
Okay, welcome back. I mentioned early on that I use lenses from about 4 different manufacturers. And that's one of the things that attracted me to mirrorless cameras, the fact that I was not necessarily stuck to the original manufacturer's glass. I had a choice to be able to go wherever I want, including back in time, which is something that I've done quite often. Another reason I like it is that I happen to like smaller lenses. I don't like carrying larger, heavier glass, and so now I can carry 3 or 4 lenses in my pocket. So my baggage has become a lot lighter, smaller, and it's a lot easier to travel. What are your thoughts about these things? So advantages aside from size, choices, what else do we have?
Well, as far as size is concerned, the first thing that came to mind is the current Sony 35-14 lens for their FE mount.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's a beautiful lens. It's really big. I mean, because compared to the Canon 35-14 Mark II, they're almost identical in size, and that's for, you know, an SLR. And I'm thinking with the wonders of adaptation, you can get a Voigtlander 35-12, which is significantly smaller, and adapt that onto your Sony. And not only are you getting a 1-2, but, you know, you're also getting a really, really small setup. So that's the first thing I thought about as soon as you mentioned
good
that.
Point.
Was that.
That's a good example.
Yeah.
And you were talking earlier, Alan, about closer focus distance.
Yeah, that's another thing. I use Voigtlander and Leica M lenses on my cameras. A lot of them. I also have Nikkor lenses I use for macros. But what's kind of neat is that I'm real big on close focusing, and to adapt my M mount lenses to my Sony, I have a Voigtlander VME adapter, which goes from Leica M to Sony E-mount, but it has a 4mm extension helicoid. So even though Leica lenses were never known for close focusing, maybe 2.5-3 feet, I'm now going within inches of the front element because I could now further extend the lens away from the camera body just by twirling the mount. And that has opened up all kinds of creative possibilities. So that's a real super thing. And if I want to go closer, I'll put an extension tube between the mount.
If not mistaken, right now the only extension tubes available is actually from Velo, because I haven't seen any other manufacturer come out with an extension tube.
And those are the ones I'm using.
Yeah, those are the ones I have too.
Yes,
I know. Kenko is a
There are actually several. On the eBay, there are several manufacturers that have an extension tubes or even helicoids. Mm-hmm. Actually, Leica did have in the early 60s dual range Summicron, which works in a similar way, if you recall.
Yes.
But now it's a lot easier, of course.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, any other advantages, Victor, that you can think of? I mean, I know you use a lot of old glass.
Well,
besides that,
as I said earlier, the main advantage is the picture quality and the character of a lens. Mm-hmm. The disadvantages, there are also several. Quite a few customers come in and they immediately dismiss electronic viewfinder. That may be an advantage and disadvantage. I do find still that Leica rangefinder, for me, since I'm used to it, is easier to focus. However, what's beautiful in electronic viewfinder, even if a lens stopped down, it may not look realistic in the viewfinder, but you can always focus. Mm-hmm. And the new viewfinders improved greatly over the last couple of years, as I've noticed some of the new Sony finders and the Fuji finder is almost spectacular.
We're at like 2 and 3 million dots of resolving power, which is it's really close to optical.
The disadvantage, well, you know, there is always disadvantages. For instance, there are quite a few lenses, especially in Leica lineup. I can't recall which ones exactly, but below 35 millimeter, there are several older 28 millimeter and old 21 super angulon that will physically not fit on some of these adapters.
There's a lot of Nikon lenses, like, well, not a lot, but some Nikon specialty lenses, such as their circle of fisheyes. Prior to the 8mm 2.8, which is actually a standard F-mount, you actually have to use mirror lockup for their,
older
cameras to actually use that.
That's another thing I think it's worth mentioning, is that if you're dealing with some of these lenses where the rear elements go deep into the camera body, you got to be careful because you might try to mount that lens and go right into the sensor. And some of these lenses come very close. So that's something you got to watch out for.
I mean, speaking of that, one of the things that, you know, I love about, you know, adapters is the fact that I owned a Canon 50.95, and prior to actually, you know, having mirrorless cameras, the only camera you can use it on is either the Canon 7 rangefinder, because it has a special breech lock mount for it, or perhaps modifying it to a M mount, which, you know, given that I'm a Canon purist and, you know, self, you know, proclaim, you know, historian, you know, that's like butchering them out. I can't really do that, you know.
Right.
So with that, it's beautiful, because when the Olympus first came out with the first mirrorless cameras, it was Micro Four Third. I wanted it, but it isn't truly what that lens was intended for, because it'll be then, you know, magnified by 2 times, making it 100.95. So thanks to the beauty of Sony, since it's full frame now, I can actually use my Canon 0.95 on the Sony full frame cameras, which is nice.
And unfortunately, it also increases its value. So nobody
which
can
is great.
One.
I mean, you know, I still remember back then I was reading on forums, you know, that lens was going for like maybe $200-$300. I got mine, you know, for a steal, you can say, for $1,000 with the camera body. And now on eBay, they're generally going for $2,500 or $3,000. So.
Correct.
And what about infinity focus issues? I remember you guys were talking about that earlier.
That's a tricky one. That is a tricky one. And that has to be case by case.
It depends on what manufacturer you're adapting to what. I mean, the biggest one I know of is probably Canon, from personal experience. When you decide to adapt a Canon FD mount lens, and I'm talking standard lens, not necessarily their super telephoto, just like 50 mil, 28 mils, and all that, you need to actually get an adapter with a piece of glass to allow for infinity focus because of the flange distance, you know, that we've mentioned earlier. Mm-hmm. The benefits of that is that, you know, you can still use it. The drawback of it is now that you're introducing another element, in which case may, you know, cause the image quality to suffer because it's not exactly up to par with what, you know, Canon designed. And also it also increased your magnification, if not mistaken, by 1.2 6, I think. I could be wrong. I mean, even back in the good old days when Canon designed the adapters themselves, they had two different adapters. They had the Canon FD to EOS macro adapter, which is basically an extension tube with two different mounts. And they actually had one specifically for their super telephoto L lenses. This was during the time in which Canon transitioned from the FD mount to the EOS mount. When they still had all these L lenses offered an FD mount, people still actually owned them, the working pros, they can actually adapt that onto their current Canon EOS bodies. Though that one also is like an extender because there's also a crop factor of, I think, 1.24 and 1.26 as well.
Mm-hmm. It may not be a problem with an adapter too. You see, quite a few of these lenses are over 70 years old. Some of them are 40 years old. Often these lenses have been serviced, but service stations can be very different. Some of them can be professional. Some of them can be so-called butchers of a photo equipment. Leica lenses generally cannot be adjusted since there's actually no adjustment screws. It is focused with a cam. DSLR lenses, Leica R lenses, any other lenses can be usually adjusted with a 3-set screw to infinity. Unfortunately, a lot of amateurish repair shops do not have a calimeter to check, an exact focus, so they just eyeball it to infinity.
Mm-hmm. You also have a wear factor. If you're dealing with a lens that you picked up, used, that could be 10, 20, 30 or more years old.
Absolutely.
There's a little bit of wear going on depending on who used it. There are some people that treat their lenses very well, and there are cowboys out there that just, yank and twist, and they don't really care. And when it no longer fits tight, they just trade in and buy a new one.
Absolutely.
And you go buy it, and you're trying to get it to work.
Yeah, I mean, that's the main issue, because when you're dealing with the used market, I mean, a lot of times, you don't know if it's been used by a pro or if it's actually been used by a collector or a hobbyist.
Yes.
I mean, I myself, like I said, coming from collecting all these Canons, if you're buying stuff from me, more likely than not, it's pretty much in mint shape. I've owned tilt shifts, I've owned circle of fish eyes. I still do own circle of fish eyes. And yeah, these are all rare items that I rarely use once in a blue. So, it's kind of hard to acquire stuff like that. I'm not planning on letting anything go, but no, I'm just saying, so depending on, what kind of item it is,
no,
whether
no
it's
advertising
rare
on the podcast, sorry.
Well, I'm not planning on selling it anyways. I mean, they're all rare items, but that's the thing. I mean, depending on who's actually owned it and who's used it, that's more or less, going to be up in the air. You really don't know since it's not a new item.
I think the bottom line for this is that, and this is something I practice on my own, whenever I get a new adapter, a new lens, the first thing I do is I do some very careful testing at wide apertures. Most all of these cameras, mirrorless cameras, have a magnifier that you can mm-hmm. zoom in when you're focusing. I get it as good as I can get it at 100%, and then I zoom in to see how accurate I am, and I play around a little bit, and I find that each adapter in each of my lenses is slightly different, but from using it regularly, it just becomes part of your routine. You don't have to think twice, and you just know, okay, this lens and adapter combination, I'm going to be doing this a little more carefully, or it doesn't matter here, or whatever the case is. So it takes a little bit more of practice and thought to get it
Me, the way I shoot, what I just do is as soon as I pick up the lens, the camera setup, just double-click to, 200% magnification uh-huh. just to get everything to critical focus, and then, just reframe and shoot. Generally, yep. That's what I do.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It seems, though, from my reading and writing here, that no matter the combination, there's always something that may not work or mm-hmm. might work, and you just need to kind of be prepared for that when you're kind of getting into the adapters and old lenses. And I guess if you're going to spend $30 on eBay and there's thousands of manufacturers out there, hundreds of manufacturers, that's no big deal. But if you're going to be spending more, you want to make sure you're going with reputable dealers so you can return if you need to.
That's exactly where my cousin's argument come into play, because, since you're working with one more thing that can go wrong, it may not be as effective for, most pros who are actually, shooting out in the field. That's mm-hmm. why, it's better to stick to OEM mount, equipment. So.
Which is a good argument to not use adapters.
Exactly. So, I mean, that's the whole thing. So, it goes both ways.
No, you have a choice. And I think it depends on first of all, who are you? What are you doing? Are you a serious enthusiast? Are you an amateur? Are you a professional? If you're a professional, I think you understand your tools that much better. And even if you're an enthusiast, you do. And, yeah, all the OEM, all the original equipment stuff. But when you start playing with adapters and stuff, you're already experimenting, you're already playing, and you're expecting surprises. And I think you have to go into it knowing that some things may not work as planned.
It's funny that you mention all this, because there are two, situations or two lenses specifically in, this, time span of history that I know that's been adapted a lot. One of them back in the good old days with manual focus, it's the Canon 35 FD tilt shift. Mm-hmm. Because a lot of Nikon shooters, you know, who are doing architectural work, you know, who need perspective control only had shift but not tilting.
Yeah.
So that is a common one that's always adapted. And then, of course, prior to Canon coming out with their 11 to 24 F4, the Nikon 14 to 24 2.8 is always being adapted to for Canon use for landscapes and stuff like that. So these are two instances that you see in history that, you know, lenses are being adapted, you know, from working professionals because the other manufacturer didn't offer it.
Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah.
And then, if not mistaken, also the picture, you know, that Vincent Laferre did of you know, the Empire State Building, you know, that circle of fisheye.
Yes.
That was prior to the 8 to 15 millimeter Canon fisheye coming out, and yeah, I believe he used a 7.5 FD fisheye to shoot that, and he modded the mount to EOS to get that shot. That's what actually got me started to hunt for that circle of fisheye, which I now own. But, you know, so, you know, it's interesting. You know, before things come out, you do see, you know, applications where working pros are adapting lenses. But, you know, it's because of, it's out of necessity, not necessarily because, you know, they're doing it for fun. So
I think it's half the fun of it, though, is actually just going out to see what things, what works and what doesn't.
It is. But, I mean, if you're on assignment where you need things, you know, to work at all times, I mean, I think you're better just playing, you know, leisurely on your own time as actually, you know, your client's time.
We're going to take another break. When we come back, we're going to talk about things to avoid when purchasing and personal stories about using adapters.
If you'd like to reach out to us with your questions or comments, email us at podcast@bhphoto.com.
Okay, welcome back. Before we get into disadvantages and anecdotes and things of that sort about adapters, let's talk a little bit about what you guys are actually using. Victor, what system are you using? What cameras, what adapters, what kind of lenses?
Actually, lens adaptation did not start with a digital era. So my very original adaptation I did myself. If you recall a large 6x7 Pentax.
Oh, yes.
That system had a very wonderful accessory. It had a helical extension tube.
Yes.
I calculated approximate focal length of a lens I can attach to it. Not saying that the Pentax lenses are poor, but I wanted, again, a different look. And I have a wonderful old, probably 1905 Gerd's Dagor. It's 120 millimeter. It was the most wonderful picture. I was able to buy a body cap in which I made a hole and with a retaining ring, screwed it in, and it's a combination I still have and still use quite often. At the moment, I'm using a Fuji X-C2 camera with several adapters. My main lens I use in that camera is actually
What adapters do you have? What brands?
It's a Fuji adapter. I purchased a Fuji adapter. It's more expensive, but it fits. There is no play.
Okay.
It fits like it was manufactured for Leica M lenses. And my favorite lens for that is actually a Rocker made by Minolta during a Leica CL era. It's a 40 millimeter, and it's a phenomenal lens. I often use a standard 50 millimeter Summicron, and I have a wonderful, it's a quite rare today and expensive to purchase on the used market, French Ingenie lens, which is made in the 50s. They have some of the cult following, and I find the rendition of these lenses cannot be matched, and it's a little awkward to use it because it's a lens made for SLR camera, so adapter is a little large, it's a little nose heavy, but because of the picture quality, it's worth a hassle.
Interesting. Yeah.
So you said you're using a Fuji adapter. Do they make adapters for a range of lenses?
Fuji only makes like an M adapter, but you can get, you know, Photodiox or Novaflex adapters practically from any DSLR camera and even some of rangefinder cameras.
Okay. And we didn't mention this too much, but Nikon and Canon, do they make adapters as well?
Well, as I mentioned earlier, Canon, I know, back in the good old days of film, there's a wide range of adapters. There's a P adapter for Pentax screw mounts. There was an N adapter, which is very, very hard to find. If you can find it, it's probably like $200-$300 for Nikon to Canon FD. They made their own Canon to Canon adapter, as I mentioned, for Canon FD to Canon EOS. Unfortunately, I'm not too well versed in Nikon. I'm sure they have adapters too, but I'm, like I said, more of a Canon guy than I am.
But if you really want to play and you really want to find out what you can do, you have to go to third-party manufacturers, right?
Usually the DSLR manufacturers made adapters, but mainly for a specialty use, not using other lenses. I would say a C-mount that is common in the telescope / microscope use.
Right. I think for the most part, I don't think manufacturers really wanted you to go outside of the family.
Not.
I
mean, of course not.
I don't think that's really a valid point, though, anymore, because the fact that since you can now take pretty much anybody's lens and put it on anybody's camera, it kind of is a wash, because if you have a Nikon, but there might be a Sony lens you like or a Canon lens or something of that sort, you now can go back and forth. So, yeah, so the manufacturer might lose out on a sale from here, but they're going to gain it from somebody else. I don't know if it really dented lens sales that much, but, again, I don't see the numbers. But it kind of leveled the playing field. Now you can go out there, you buy a camera, but you're not limited to choices of lenses, and you can buy brand-new lenses from another manufacturer.
It's funny that one of these lens manufacturers have this the same idea, but for their lenses, if I'm not mistaken, it was Vivitar with the adapt all mount back then.
Sure,
T-mount. So, yeah. And Tamron, yeah, because I know Vivitar had a lot of those screw mounts also.
Right.
And the thing is, you could buy their lenses and adapt to whatever camera body you want. Right. So, I mean, that's, I guess, the idea behind that, similar to nowadays with the adapters for lenses. Mm-hmm.
Yep. So, Johnny, what are you playing with now? What are you shooting?
Where do I start?
He's a Nikon. He's a Nikon guy.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Currently, the only mirrorless camera I have that can take any lenses or lens adaptations is a Sony A7. I've owned the A7R. I've owned the A7S. My current A7 is actually infrared converted. So, with that, I have so many adapters. I mean, I really don't even know where to start, to be honest with you. I have an adapter for my dedicated Canon 50.95. I have an M39 mount. I have M42. I have, surprisingly, I don't have Leica M, but I had a Nikon to NEX. I have the Metabones EOS to NEX. I have a Hasselblad, their 500 series cameras to NEX. I also purchased a Micro Four Third to NEX, but unfortunately never had a chance to use it. But yeah, I mean, as far as the whole lightweight thing goes, it's very interesting because, when shooting with my mirrors, it's kind of funny because I never really travel light. I mean, last time I went on a trip, I was carrying a Hasselblad and, a whole other setup. But with lens adaptation is great because, for me, if I feel like it, I can, shoot with my older 35 f2 Canon screw mount. Instead of bringing, a larger, 35 mil specifically for the Sony system, I can use that and shoot film simultaneously, so... Mm-hmm.
Just don't travel internationally. Don't think you're a camera smuggler.
Too late.
You brought up a good point, though, is that you said depending on what your mood is and what you want to do, it's interesting to be able to think of lens choices, not of just focal length, but, what kind of a look do I want this shot to have? Because I'm, you have, I think, was it 70 different 50-millimeter lenses?
Well, I wouldn't say 70, but, I mean, ballpark, maybe about 24.
Okay, and each one of those lenses has its own personality.
That's the thing. I have yet to do a test to see what they all look like. It's just that, since I'm in all these different manufacturers, each time you buy a camera, you get a 50 mil. That's what you start with. So, before you know it, you just, start gathering all these different 50s. I mean... from 50.95, 50, I had a 1.5 for a Canon screw mount, 53.5 Elmar for Leica. The list just keeps going on, to be honest with you. I mean,
do you think anybody collects 18-55 kit lenses? I'm just curious.
No.
Absolutely not.
The used store does, maybe.
That repair shops, I'm guessing, I mean, for what it's worth.
It's funny. One of the things that I think we've all experienced with lens adapters is that little surprises that you get. I have a Zeiss 16-millimeter Hologon, which is made for the Contax G-series cameras back in the 90s, and it's a wonderful little lens. And I was able to find a third-party, really obscure little adapter that goes from Contax G to the Sony without a flange so I could put this lens on it. Most of them it didn't work with. And it first was a little pin sticking out, so I had to epoxy that down so that I can get the lens to sit flat. And then I found that when I put the lens and adapter on the Sony body and I turned it on and took a picture, the camera froze and jammed. And it's basically because the rear element was going in too far. Luckily, it didn't damage anything. And I don't know how I don't know whether I found it online or just from playing around. I found that I can use the lens on the camera. I just had to use silent shutter. I couldn't use the camera's mechanical shutter, but switch it over to silent shutter mode, which the Sony's beautiful at. And now I could take this camera that was a lens that was never designed for this purpose and use it in a whole new venue. So that was, to me, is kind of interesting. And again, these are the things you don't expect and you don't find out about when, you know, you're just ordering a piece
online.
Yeah,
honestly speaking, my heart's kind of aching right now because I'm a purist and I can't believe you had to put epoxy in a lens. That hurts.
No, not on a lens, on the adapter.
Oh, on the adapter.
On the adapter. Oh, no.
I almost had a heart attack.
No. First, you did not hear that here. And you guys have any kind of stories like that? Anything where, you know, you just something came up that was unexpected?
I mean, the only thing that I know that I had an issue with, as I mentioned before, is with the Leica 50 Elmar, because, you know, it's a collapsible lens and, you know, the infinity lock is right up against where, you know, it would mount to, like, the mount.
Mm-hmm.
And the thing is, when you screw it into the adapter, if you have it set on infinity, you can't move it out because, you know, due to the contact, it's just stuck up right against the adapter. And if you leave it off of infinity and then you screw it on, then you won't be able to attain infinity focus because the lens won't ever move to that position. So
yeah, this is because these adapters are actually too thick. If you notice these lenses, it's an interesting, that's a fascinating lens. It's one of my favorite lenses to adapt is a Leica Elmar 50 millimeter, which is such a classic, and it has a certain look.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And if you notice that on the side, you know, the Leica has an M39 mount to Leica M adapters. They made for many years since Leica M, so yeah. You could use old lenses. Mm-hmm. You have to be careful how to use them or read an instruction book, because sometimes Leica M's with a self-timer that, in you know, that focusing tab can actually go too far, and you may not be able to screw it in if the adapter is in the camera. So you have to put an adapter first and then bayonet it into a camera.
I should actually try that with the Elmar, because I'd love to try to
you
use it on the Sony.
That, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, given the fact that it's uncoated, it should actually give some really interesting results, especially shooting infrared, too. So,
you guys have any ideas, any thoughts about things to avoid when purchasing adapters?
Things to look for and to avoid, yeah.
You need to avoid is not to expect miracles, especially with a autofocus adapter. So I'll give you one example. Olympus, prior to their Micro Four Thirds system, had an old Four Thirds system, which was actually a DSLR. And they had the wonderful lenses of very good quality. They had some cheap lenses, but they had quite a few exotic lenses. Unfortunately, the system ceased the production, and they made an adapter, so you can use it on Micro Four Thirds, and it works with autofocus. Where you have to be careful, if the lens is so special to you, you're probably better off using it manually with an autofocus, because it's painfully slow.
Oh, yeah, I mean, that reminds me of when Metabones first came out with their so-called autofocus adapter. Everybody's expecting it to work so smoothly with the A7s, and it's constantly hunting until finally the A7 R2 came out, where, you know, things are actually working significantly better now.
I think it's probably in another few years the autofocus issue will be less of an issue than it is right
Absolutely.
Now. Because right now, my take on it is that autofocus adapters are where autofocus was 20 years ago. You know, it works, but it's got a lot of limitations. You know?
Yeah, I think it's very difficult for them to match the electronics.
And so also keep in mind, it's not the original manufacturer that's doing all this stuff.
Of course.
Now you got it's like dealing with software and peripherals.
Right.
It's like, yeah, every once in a while it all works together, but usually it doesn't. Something is kind of goofy about it. That's
exactly.
The nature of the beast.
All right. So, but let's just say, for example, you're out, you know, scouring through a used market or eBay. Are there manufacturers to avoid? Not that we want to trash anybody, but are there things that when you're looking to buy an adapter, you can, let's say for the listener at home or someone who's just getting into it, that they can kind of read through the lines?
I mean, depending on the application, I mean, not necessarily for adapters, but I tell them, you know, if you're doing cinema, hunt for Nikon lenses, you know, if you're shooting on a Canon, because those are the easiest ones I see to adapt to actually use. You know, you get Nikkor optics, and also, you get a wonderful little setup for cheap.
You put a Nikon lens on a Canon camera, and you're good to go, right?
Well, for cinema, at least. I mean, I wouldn't waste my time doing that for stills, because Canon has plenty of awesome, you know, EF lenses, but, you know.
For the cinema applications, though, there.
Yeah, I mean,
sense.
A lot of people shooting on a budget, instead of buying, you know, Rokinon cine lenses and stuff like that, which is good because, you know, cinema lenses, you know, do play an essential role in, you know, shooting cinema. But at the same time, if, you know, you don't want to spend that kind of money for, say, a 50 mil, you can just pick up a cheap, you know, 50 non-AI, you know, Nikon 1.4, you know, for like, what, $80, something like that.
We have advantages of price, size, experimental options. Cinema use, Anything else you throw out there? I mean, what do people come in when they're looking to buy, other than cinema makers and
mirrorless? To be honest, I guess it's just a whole mystery, you know, that that's shrouded, you know, with the older lenses. You know, everybody's wondering, you know, how did all these, you know, images look from back then? Like, what can these lenses do that, you know, that the current lenses aren't doing? Because a lot of lenses nowadays, like we've mentioned before, is also all for sharpness and resolution, but, you know, they lack character. Mm-hmm. You know, they have this, you know, like very clean, clinical look to it, and they don't really have any character that, you know, can set one image apart from another. So I guess what that's what a lot of people's looking for, is to, you know, make their images look unique by, you know, shooting with lenses that offer different looks and different characteristics. I guess that's the most important thing.
I think majority of customers that deal with lens adapters are actually quite familiar with what they're buying,
right?
Because even on the floor, I see a lot of people, especially with the current full-frame Sony cameras. Almost every 20 minutes, I see somebody with Sony 7 and a Leica lens. You know, it's quite obvious.
You mean I'm not the only one?
Hmm?
I'm not the only one?
You're not the only one.
No. I'm sorry.
God. No wonder people aren't staring at me anymore. one thing I do want to add, though, to this conversation, we talk about quality of stuff. And there are a lot of variations in quality. And yet you have companies like Novaflex that, as a rule, when you buy a Novaflex adapter, they are really good. They're precision. They're built. You pick them up, you know you got a good item in your hand, and they do hit infinity, and they really, everything fits really, really well. I've also used adapters that don't cost $300 or $400. They cost $30 or $25, and some of them have been terrible, and they went back, and some of them are actually perfectly fine. So I think that's really the big thing, is that, yes, you can buy cheaper adapters, but you really have to check them out carefully before you start using them. You might be good. You may not be good.
Well, not even that. You just got to make sure that, you know, when you purchase a cheaper adapter, that it actually has the function that you're looking for. Because I know Velo offers them an EOS to NEX mount without autofocus. So you literally just mount, you know, put the lens onto the camera and mount it onto the camera, and that's it.
Mm-hmm.
But then you have to understand that you don't have aperture control. So, you know, you have to understand what you're purchasing also. You don't want to buy that and think, oh, it's $50, it'll work with my lens. But then you lose the most essential part, which is changing your aperture.
Yes.
I mean, unless, you know, all you're planning on doing is shooting wide open the whole time. But then at the same time, certain lenses require communication, you know, for focus, such as the Canon 85-1.2, because it's still focused by wire.
Yes.
So your camera has to be, you know, powered on, you know, with the contacts, you know, communicating through the adapter to the lens. So those are some things that they have to think about also, is, you know, what exactly are you buying it for, and what is your adapter actually going to do for you versus what it won't do for you. So
this is also one of the reasons why a lot of people are going for older lenses, because older lenses, aperture rings. You're able to physically
set. Yeah, less of a headache,
set.
And, you know, you just mount it on, mm-hmm. and everything's mechanical. And, of course, the build quality is a lot better than most modern lenses, too. I mean, you know, 51.8 Nikon, you know, compared to 51.8, you know, modern Nikon. I mean, it's day and night, you know, real metal construction versus plastic. So,
This is something else that people may want to avoid, because I hear some customers find something on eBay from unknown source. I've even heard somebody selling actual bayonet mounts where you unscrew the screw and put a different mount, which, you know, I did not see the item, but this is one of customers told me. So I would strongly advise not to do this.
Though the only one that's reputable that I know of for Canon FD to EOS is Ed Mika. That's a very popular one that I've heard of, you know, where they said that it's very easy to, you know, put the original mount back on also. I mean, I've never had any personal experience because, again, I can't see myself butchering my, you know, lenses. But
right,
I mean,
right, right.
Also, I think if you don't have experience taking a lens apart, don't do it.
Don't
unless,
touch.
Unless you could afford mentally and financially to write it off if something goes south.
Or just practice with something cheaper. I mean,
exactly.
You know, don't use a $1,000 lens and, you know, start butchering that. Use like a cheap 51.8 or something like that, and, you know, start taking it apart.
Mm-hmm.
You need the butter knife for that one.
Okay. Well, this has been very informative. This has also been fun. Thank you, Victor. Thank you, Johnny. Thank you, John Harris, my producer. And thank you, Jason Taples, our engineer. And let me remind you that your feedback is very, very important to us. So take a few moments and tweet us at BH Photo Video with hashtag BH Photo Podcast and rate us on iTunes. My name is Alan Weitz. Thank you so much for tuning in today.